This week marks the 7th anniversary of the From the Vault podcast, and I would like to thank all the viewers for the 7 years of support. Let's continue this as long as possible. If you're a first-time listener to this, welcome. My name is James, a 33-year-old pro wrestling fan. I've been a fan pretty much my entire life. This podcast covers wrestling topics from the past, such as old pay-per-view reviews, wrestler retrospectives, the occasional company and belt retrospective, and any other topic from the past that comes to mind. Mainly, I cover past WWE, WCW, ECW, and TNA on here, although there will be things from other stuff here and there as well. And other than Over the Edge 1999, any topic from pro wrestling's past is up for discussion on this podcast. I have over 300 episodes in the archive, so there's no shortage of episodes to check out. So if you're a longtime fan of pro wrestling and want to hear about subjects from the past, or a newer pro wrestling fan who wants to find out about stuff before your time as a fan, I highly suggest subscribing to this channel. I interact as much as I can on here, so leave a comment down below. Also, follow me on all my social media platforms, links down below to those as well. Thank you for 7 years of the podcast. Next week marks 14 years for the We Are Pro Wrestling channel. Thanks again for all the support. And now on to this week's topic. And that topic is an anniversary of another sort, as this week is all about WWF No Mercy 1999. This show took place on October 17th, 1999, from the Gund Arena in Cleveland, Ohio, now known as Rocket Mortgage Fieldhouse, formerly known as Quicken Loans Arena. This would be the second No Mercy 1999 that the WWF had. The first one took place May 16th over in the UK. That was a UK-exclusive pay-per-view. They decided to reuse the name and do one over here in the States. The attendance for this event was 18,742, with 298,000 pay-per-view buys. Your commentators for the night were the legendary commentary duo of Jim Ross and Jerry Lawler. In total on the night, there were 9 matches with 3 championships on the line, also a ladder match for $100,000, and the managerial services of Terry Runnels. With all that out of the way, it's now time for the matches of WWF No Mercy 1999. Kicking things off with match number 1, it's the Godfather versus Mideon. This one stems from an earlier match between the two. Godfather would make his usual pre-match offer of his lady friends or a match against him. Mideon wanted dead farm animals instead, and Godfather called him a freak. This time around, there would be no such offer, and it would just be a match between the two. As opening matches go, this one, it was definitely on the show. Not really that good. It's one of those examples of a TV match that should have really been on TV and not on pay-per-view, but hey, gotta fill the cards somehow. This era played a role multiple times during the match, so pretty much it was a handicap match, but the Battle of the BSK would end when Godfather hit Mideon with the Hoe Train, the pin, and Godfather would pick up the win in 7 minutes 31 seconds. Post-match, Godfather's lady friends would celebrate the victory with Tim White in the ring. Up next was match number 2. It was the first of 3 championships on the line on this show. This one was for the World Wrestling Federation Women's Championship. Champion Ivory versus challenger, the Fabulous Moolah. After Unforgiven, both Moolah and Mae Young started feuding with Women's Champion Ivory, all of this leading to a title match between Ivory and the former champion at No Mercy. And why in the actual fuck was Moolah getting a title shot in 1999? Like, if anything, granted, neither should have been getting title shots in 1999. Both Moolah and Mae were 76 years old. However, then and now, if one forced one or the other had to get a title shot, I think most would have rather seen Mae get a title shot. Hell, Mae took more bumps than Moolah during this match, so it really should have been Ivory versus Mae for the women's title here. The match, as expected, like, what were you expecting with this? This was absolutely terrible. God bless Ivory. She could only do so much here. And in 3:01, one of the lowest points in WWE women's wrestling history took place. Moolah, at 76 years old, wins the WWF Women's Championship. After that was match number 3, and initially this was set to be for the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Championships, Champions the New Age Outlaws versus Challengers the Holly Cousins. Hardcore and Crash Holly have been feuding with the Outlaws since after Unforgiven, and a title match was set up for No Mercy. However, the Holly Cousins would cost the Outlaws the Tag Team Championships on the Go Home episode of SmackDown to the Rock and Sock Connection, so now the Outlaws versus the Holly Cousins was a non-title match. Now, Outlaws versus Hollies was your standard paint-by-number tag team match. Nothing that will light the world on fire, but nothing that will offend you either. The titles being involved or not involved wouldn't have changed much about this match. This still would have been your standard tag team match. Both teams would do their thing. Did have a lackluster finish, however. Hardcore threw a chair into the ring. Gunn gave Crash a Famouser onto the chair. The referee would see that, called for the bell. Disqualification finish, as the Holly Cousins picked up the win in 10:11, and this was kind of a de facto number one contendership match, as the following night on Raw, the Hollies defeated the Rock and Sock Connection to become the new WWF Tag Team Champions. Following that was match number 4, one of the more famous matches on this pay-per-view. The second of 3 championships on the line. This one was the good housekeeping match for the World Wrestling Federation Intercontinental Championship. Champion Jeff Jarrett versus challenger Chyna. Jarrett retained via disqualification at Unforgiven after Deborah used a guitar on Jarrett. Chyna initially won that match, but thanks to scab referee Tom Pritchard, the decision was reversed. Chyna earned another shot at the Intercontinental title at No Mercy, but Jarrett, in his anti-woman stage of his career, made this a good housekeeping match. A match where household items were allowed to be used. Now, this one is famous for a couple of reasons. First, the outcome of the match, which I'll talk about in a little bit. But second, Jeff's demands. It's one of the more notable things about Jeff Jarrett's entire pro wrestling career. So October 16th, the day before the pay-per-view, Jeff Jarrett's WWF contract expired. He was on his way back to WCW, joining up with Vince Russo, who just went over himself. The story for years was that Jeff pulled an Ultimate Warrior. He held Vince up for money, and if he didn't get the money, he wasn't gonna wrestle. There's also been rumors, conspiracy theories, that the outcome the month prior at Unforgiven was changed, so that way Jarrett's contract would expire right before the rematch. All sorts of different stuff. And then in recent years, you've got Jeff's side of the story. First off, he never really wanted to leave the WWF, but he got an offer with WCW. The WWF wasn't gonna match it, so he took the WCW deal. And he was always gonna work the match against Chyna, but Jeff had leverage, and he knew he had leverage because legally, he didn't have to do anything since he didn't have a contract. The WWF needed business done, Jeff needed business done, and any money Jeff wanted wasn't money out of the blue. He wanted money that was owed to him in royalties, as well as working the show itself. So after a back and forth between the two sides, they agreed on $300,000. Jeff got his money, and the match was gonna take place. The good housekeeping match itself was a fun weapons-based brawl, and you saw a lot of unconventional weapons being used here, like a toilet seat, the kitchen sink, pies, salad tongs. It was a good, fun match here between these two. Jarrett would use the IC title belt and get the initial win. However, referee Teddy Long saw Jarrett with the belt. He had the match restarted because the Intercontinental title belt, quote, is not a household item. So naturally, the match ended with a not a household item being used as Chyna used a guitar on Jarrett, and pro wrestling history was made in 9 minutes 57 seconds as Chyna won the WWF Intercontinental Championship, becoming the first woman to ever hold a men's championship in WWE history. This was a huge moment and the next logical progression of Chyna's character. She debuted beating up men, so naturally she eventually had to have match against men. She would have matches against men, was beating men in matches, so the next progression is, okay, put a belt on her, and she became the number two champion in the company. She was now the Intercontinental Champion, and 1999 overall was the biggest year for the ninth wonder of the world. After that was match number 5. It was The Rock versus the British Bulldog. Since his return in early September, the Bulldog had a mission statement. He wanted to win the one championship that eluded him his entire career. He was already Intercontinental Champion, Tag Team Champion, European Champion, but British Bulldog wanted to win the World Wrestling Federation Championship. Bulldog would turn heel on The Rock prior to Unforgiven. After losing during the six-pack challenge and against Triple H, Bulldog would snap. He was going to take his aggression out on anyone until he got another shot at the WWF title. Rock gave Bulldog a rock bottom into dog shit on an episode of Raw, and we would get a match between these two here at No Mercy. And the one-month main event Bulldog push was done after this match. You know, had Bulldog been 100% healthy, he would have been a big asset in the upper card in the WWF at this time. That wasn't the case. The match between Rock and Bulldog was all right at best. Luckily, they kept it short, under 10 minutes. We got some pay-per-view Bulldog chin locks during this. In 6 minutes 20 seconds, The Rock would pick up the win after a rock bottom and a people's elbow. Now, when you say No Mercy 1999, this is the match that most people think of. It's match number 6, the final match in the Best of 5 Terry Invitational Tournament. This would be a ladder match for $100,000 and the managerial services of Terry Runnels, Edge and Christian versus the New Brood, aka the Hardy Boys. So after Meat and the Mean Street Posse failed, Terry was looking for a brand new client. So she used the ongoing feud between Edge and Christian and the Hardy Boys to determine who her new client would be. The two teams would compete in the Terry Invitational Tournament, which, by the way, this was one of the last Russo naming schemes before he left to go to WCW, and you can tell it was one of his because, well, just look at the name, Terry Invitational Tournament. Don't have to spell it out for you. This would be a best of five series. It ended up being tied 2-2. A fifth match would be decided here, the first ever tag team ladder match. This match was a career maker for all involved because this was the match that put Edge, Christian, Jeff Hardy, and Matt Hardy on the map. It would help spawn the triangle ladder match with the Dudleys at WrestleMania 2000, which there spawned the TLC matches, and these would change the ladder match forever, as you see pieces of this ladder match in almost every ladder match in the modern day. Shawn and Razor and their ladder matches inspired these four with this ladder match, and these four with this ladder match inspired about dozens and dozens of wrestlers today with ladder matches. Like, the stuff you saw in this match, you had never seen before prior. Like, remember, this was 1999. Ladder matches on a main stage weren't even a decade old at this point. And prior to this, Edge and Christian and the Hardys would get some reaction, but not big ones. But after this, they got a standing ovation, and you rarely saw standing ovations at this point in time in wrestling. And not only did they get a standing ovation post-match, they got a standing ovation the night after on Raw. And can you believe it? 25 years later, these four are still going strong. You saw what became the ladder grab animation in No Mercy N64 at the end here when Jeff grabbed the sack of money. In 16 minutes, 30 seconds, the Hardys won the deciding match in the Terry Invitational Tournament, winning kayfabe $100,000 and Terry as their new manager. This would end up being the Hardys' babyface turn as well. Up next was kind of an odd match. Match number 7, Val Venus versus Mankind. It was that period of time when they tried Val as an upper card heel for a little bit of time. Val would steal Mr. Rocco after Rock, This Is Your Life, and stick the sock down his pants. You had some miscommunication between Rock and Foley. They were going to team up just one more time and be done, but that one more time led to them becoming the new tag team champions. Mankind wanted the sock back, so we were going to get a match between Foley and Val here at the pay-per-view. This one was... Val was more of a middle-of-the-card guy and not an upper-card guy in the WWF. Pairing Val against Foley didn't really work well. The match itself was not that good. It also didn't help that they had to follow the tag team ladder match. I mean, something had to. Unfortunately, it was this one. What we got was one of Foley's worst pay-per-view matches during his WWF tenure. For some reason, Val got the win. 9 minutes, 26 seconds was the time, and I bet most people probably forgot this match ever happened. The penultimate match of No Mercy 1999 took place after that, match number 8, a Four Corners elimination match, Kane versus X-Pac versus Farouk versus Bradshaw. Initially, this was a tag team match, Kane and X-Pac versus the Acolytes. This was during the time of X-Pac's slow heel turn. He wanted to prove himself in the land of the giants. He didn't want Kane's help anymore. Even when he asked not for any help, Kane still helped, leading to a strain in their team. Kane eventually acted the same, not wanting any help from X-Pac, to which X-Pac ignored as well, so instead of a tag team match, we would get a Four Corners elimination match here at the pay-per-view. So two guys were wrestling in the ring while the other two were on the apron. Anyone can tag anyone in, eliminations take place, and the last man left is the winner. To be fair, I would have rather seen either a tag match between the two teams, or one-on-one with Kane and X-Pac. Now, they might be a team at this point, but the reason for a one-on-one, have it similar to Razor and X-Pac, formerly 1-2-3 Kid, from the fall of 1999 on Raw, where the two have a match, cooler heads prevail seemingly, and then X-Pac turns heel. Bradshaw was eliminated first, and then Kane. It was down to X-Pac and Farouk. After a reversal into an X-Factor, Farouk was eliminated last, and in 10 minutes, 8 seconds, X-Pac would pick up the win here. The match itself, it was okay at best. Alright, main event time. Match number 9, the third and final championship on the line at this show, this one being for the World Wrestling Federation Championship. Champion Triple H versus challenger Steve Austin. Triple H put Austin on the shelf at SummerSlam after the main event. Austin would return weeks later on SmackDown to attack Triple H after the tag team buried alive match. Austin cost Triple H the WWF Championship against McMahon on SmackDown. After Austin reinstated McMahon, he was given a title shot to whoever won the six-pack challenge at Unforgiven, of which Austin was the enforcer too. After Austin did his job, he counted the three. Triple H won the six-pack challenge. He was the new WWF champion, to which Austin would stun Triple H afterwards. Triple H would use a sledgehammer on a bag with a rattlesnake inside it to send a message to Austin, leading Austin luring Triple H into a room with a rattlesnake in it. Triple H would trick Austin into thinking he got bit by the rattlesnake, so the match was just going to be a regular one-on-one match at No Mercy. But then on Sunday Night Heat prior to the pay-per-view, the match was made no holds barred after McMahon figured out Triple H's plan. He knew Triple H would make Austin so angry on purpose to try to get Austin to make another mistake and get disqualified. However, that plan wasn't gonna work out, as now the match was no holds barred. So naturally, because the match is no holds barred during Triple H's entrance, McMahon tried to take the sledgehammer away from Hunter because, you know, last time I checked, no holds barred means no rules, but whatever. One thing you'll notice here is the WWF forgot to cover the entire floor of the Gund Arena because during the opening brawl with Austin and Triple H, they brawl on the calves' hardwood, leading to slipping and sliding. The match here was the wild brawl of the time for a big-time WWF main event. Thank God they made it into a no-holds-barred match, because it not only fit the story between the two, it also would hide Austin's limitations. Like, this was around the time. Like, look at the date of this show, October 1999. 1 month later, Austin is written off of TV with him getting ran down by the car at the Survivor Series. Hell, only about 2 weeks later does the WWF find out that Austin can't wrestle anymore unless he gets surgery. Even then, there's no guarantee he'll ever wrestle again. This would end up being Austin's last pay-per-view match for a year. These two would have better matches later on, but this one was still very good. Rock would come out all banged up because earlier on, after Rock declared himself the number one contender, he'll fight either Triple H or Austin next. Triple H would attack The Rock. Rock had a sledgehammer. He swung it toward Triple H. He missed. He accidentally hit Austin. Triple H would retain the WWF Championship in 21 minutes 55 seconds. Huge brawl post-match, leading to Triple H escaping with his belt. Now, the WWF in 1999 was not known for having great pay-per-views. See WrestleMania, see King of the Ring, see SummerSlam, see Survivor Series. Not a great year for the big ones. However, in terms of the B pay-per-views, that's where you got some good shows here and there. No Mercy 1999 was a really good one. It was one of the better WWF pay-per-views that year. This was highlighted by three things: the amazing tag team ladder match, the Golden Ring Bell for best match, the good housekeeping match with Chyna winning the Intercontinental Championship, and the no holds barred match with Triple H and Austin for the WWF title in the main event. Everything else ranged from average to meh. Like, the one lone absolutely terrible thing on this show was Ivory versus Moolah for the women's title, Brown Ring Bell for worst match. If you've never seen No Mercy 1999 before, I do recommend it to you, especially to see the ladder match and both the Intercontinental and World title matches. The vault may be closed on No Mercy 1999, but you can open the vault back up on some other WWE pay-per-view reviews I've done over the years, so click the card for those, as well as opening up the vault to the entire From the Vault archive. Click that card as well. Peace.